Praise the Lord. God is good. Amen. How many are happy to be in the house of the Lord? How many are thankful for Jesus? Aren't you? I mean, here we are celebrating Christmas, and we really, really, really need to refocus and remember why we're celebrating this holiday, you know. And why don't we stand up on our feet this morning and just give the Lord some praise. He's worthy to be praised. Amen. The Savior has come into the world. And he purchased with his death, his burial, and his resurrection, God's incredible plan for mankind, paid the price of sin. And without that happening, we were doomed eternally to death and destruction. But because he came, we are born again. Amen. And those, this is a free gift for all those who would believe. Do I have any believers here this morning? Amen. Amen. Glory to God. So welcome to Abundant Grace Church. Welcome those who are joining us online. Take this time, set it aside. It's important. Get your family together. Get your Bible. Get something to take some notes. And let's prepare to hear from God. Amen.
Amen.
Father, we thank you for this day. Lord, this truly is the day that you have made. Hallelujah. We worship you, Father. We honor you. Today, may you be glorified in all that is said, all that is done. Father, may people see you and receive the gift of repentance, the greatest gift of all, the free gift of salvation. We thank you for it. Hallelujah. There's a longing in my heart for more and more of you. There's a craving in my life, a yearning for your truth. There's a searching in my today.
Lord of all creation, the water, earth, and sky, heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy. Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high.
Sing it out.
God of wonders beyond. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy.
God of wonders.
God of wonders beyond our galaxy.
Thank you.
Receive from you the gift of salvation, Father, the gift of grace, the help that we need. We thank you that you are worthy, worthy to be praised. You're such a good, good, good Father. You're the best. And we honor you today. And all that we say and do, may it bring glory to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, you may be seated. We're going to continue to worship the Lord with our substance. We just worshiped him in song. Now we're going to honor him with our tithes and offerings, our first fruits of our increase. Amen. God is increasing us. Do you believe that, church?
Yes.
Who is your source? Let me ask you.
God.
Who is your source? Say it again. Some of you get it. Some aren't sure. Who is your source? God is your source. Is your job your source? Is your rich uncle your source? Is any other thing your source? So that means when all that goes away, guess who's still supplied? You guys are supplied because God is our source.
Amen.
Amen. So if you'd like an offering for your an envelope for your offering, an offering for your envelope, either way, that makes sense too, though, right? You got to put an offering in your envelope. But whatever, if you need one, you know what I'm saying. Raise your hands. Ushers will give you one. If you're giving online, you can do that from our website, or you can text your offering to 732-856-5050. And, you know, we declare all the time that our needs are met according to his riches and glory. We sow in faith and we reap in faith. You understand that? So what does that mean? It takes faith to give, but it takes faith to receive as well. So once we've sown our seed in the ground, this is important. The head of the church, Jesus, spoke this personally to Brother Hagin, who's now in heaven, and told him that people are missing it on the area of reaping. Because they sow in faith, but then that's the end of it. They don't do anything else about it. To reap, you have to reap in faith. So what does that mean? That means that we need to tell the enemy and every wicked force of darkness to take its hands off of our finances. God is not going to rain money out of heaven. What we need is here. It's already on this earth, but there's hindrances to it coming to us. The enemy does not want to see us prosperous because he knows that if Christians are prosperous, he knows what we're going to do with it. Well, what are we going to do with it? We're going to establish God's covenant. We're going to give. We're going to continue giving. We're going to help people. We're going to pay people's mortgage off. We're going to pay for their groceries. We're going to buy them cars. We're going to build buildings. And we're going to continue to spread the gospel, the good news, right? So he doesn't want that to happen. Can you understand why he wouldn't want that to happen? But we don't care because he's not in charge. We are surrendered to God, and we are in this world but not of it. So what we have to do when we give, we sow in faith, but then we need to, and I'm teaching you this because it's helped helped a lot of us in understanding that it's not just throwing your seed into the ground, but now you need to speak over your seed. And it takes faith to reap. So what do? We bind the work of the enemy from hindering our finances, tying it up in any way. We recognize that God is the source, but he uses channels here on this earth, right? I pray to be a channel. I want to be a channel. I want to be a conduit. I want to have a lot so that the Lord can tap me and say, hey, buy their car for them. But how many knows I need to have surplusage to do that?
Yes,
you know, so I'm not writing faith checks. I have to have substance to do that with, right? And we get substance by sowing. And then we release faith to reap. So we tell the enemy, I do it every day, take your hands off our finances. Anything that's hindering it from coming into this church and into our families and into my church family, I bind it in Jesus' name. And then we commission our ministering spirits, angels, to go forth and bring it to us. That's scriptural. That came from the head of the church, Jesus. That is good inside information that will produce a result in your life. Do you believe that this morning?
Yes,
that's why I get excited to sow, because I know that as I'm sowing, I'm not giving to get. I'm giving because I will have surplus so that I could be a blessing to others. And I recognize that God is our source. So that's why I do it in faith, and I do it willingly, I do it quickly, and I do it joyfully to do it, because God is faithful. He's been good to us. And it doesn't matter, because my job is not my source. God is my source. And he said, prove me this day. Prove me this day, he said, that I would not open up the windows of heaven and pour you out blessings that you wouldn't even have enough room and time to contain it all. And that he would rebuke the devourer for our sake. Do you believe that this morning? I believe it. God is doing it in our life. He's doing it in this church. And he'll do it in your life if you'll believe him and you'll do exactly what we're just talking about now. And I thank God for the faithfulness of those who are giving, because you have been faithful. How many are seeing results in their life? I'm telling you, one Sunday we're just going to have testimony Sunday, and we're going to let people stand up and begin to share what God has done in their life. And by doing that, it's going to stir up other people's faith.
Yes, amen.
Amen. Because it's not just for a few, it's for all who would believe. Amen.
Yes, amen.
So let's, I gave everyone enough time to text whatever you have to, write whatever you need to. And let's trust the Lord this morning. Amen. Let's sow in faith, and then let's release faith to reap. Amen.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, I thank you, Father, that as an under-shepherd here at Abundant Grace Church, Father, with an awesome responsibility over your sheep, Lord, I speak blessings over the lives of all the people as they sow today, as they sow in faith, as they give willingly, Father. I thank you that you said to prove you this day, that you would open up the windows of heaven. So, Father, I thank you for abundance and surplus coming into their lives. Father, we rebuke the devourer. We rebuke the enemy from tying up our finances in any way, shape, or form. But we declare that it's flowing freely to us, that our ministering spirits are bringing it to us, not so that we can pad our accounts, but so that we have more than enough to give to whoever is in need as you direct us. So, Father, I thank you that every need is met in this church and in the lives of the people. Every bill is paid in full, and every debt is reduced and eliminated. Eliminated. That means mortgages. That means car payments. That means debts. As we sow, Father, you are the need meter. You are Jehovah Jireh, our provider. And we give you all the glory, all the honor. We thank you for it today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Glory to God. You may receive the offering. God wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. God of wonder, God of wonder beyond our galaxy. You are.
No. Hey. Morning, guys.
All right, so just a couple of announcements before we get Pastor Eddie get started with the word. Before we do get started, do we have any first-time visitors? Anybody visiting us for the first time, raise up your hand. We want to say hello. All right, so you've all been here before. The gift cards. So all our gift cards are in for the children's families that are, or the families with the children that were on the checklist. So those will be distributed. So if you are collecting those for a family or you are one of those families, they're going to be given out on Tuesday from 12 to 2 p.m. So just come out, grab the gift cards for the children for your family. Also, just I want to kind of just make sure you guys are, everybody's on the same page with the next 2 weeks for service schedules because of the holidays. So this week upcoming, we're going to have our regular Tuesday and Wednesday Faith and Healing School at 10:30. Wednesday evening at 7 p.m. will be our candle lighting service. Okay, so just a reminder, come out, mark your calendar for this Wednesday. It's Christmas Eve Eve. Thursday and Friday, because of the holiday, will be no Faith and Healing School. Sunday, upcoming next Sunday, as usual, 10 a.m. And then the following week, we're doing it the same way. So Tuesday, this is New Year's week. So Tuesday and Wednesday, 10:30 a.m., Faith and Healing School. Wednesday evening service, as usual. And then no Healing School on Thursday and Friday. Okay? We all got that? So just think about it. New Year's Eve, New Year's Day, Christmas Eve, Christmas Day, no Faith and Healing School. Everything else remains the same. Amen? All right. We all got that? All right. See me after if you want a refresher. Glory to God.
Lord, thank you, Brother Frank. Am I on? What do we got, a delayed action here? Check one, two, check one. Check one, two. Check one, two. I can barely hear it. Can you hear it? It's okay? All right. I'm loud. I could be loud. Praise the Lord. God is good. Amen. How many are happy to be in church this morning? Glory to God. Good. Glory to God. Well, good morning and welcome. I did. I'm going to say that. Heard you. Good morning and welcome to Abundant Grace Church. How many are prepared to hear the word? Amen. The word is alive. It's living. It's powerful. It's exactly what we need to overcome. Amen. What do we say here? Faith comes by what? Hearing anything? Hearing what? The word. The word. We spoke last week about growing our faith. Remember, I gave us four principles to practice in having our faith grow and develop. So glory to God. I just want to take a moment. How nice the church looks. Doesn't it look beautiful? It does. Thank everybody who has helped us and made it possible. You know, without if any successful church has a seriously thriving helps team that gets things done. And sometimes we don't see that. The people who come in here may not see it, but we know it. And God, most importantly, knows it. You know, and everything that we do is unto the Lord anyway. But so it does look beautiful, and the tree in the foyer looks beautiful. So we're grateful for that. You have your Bible. Open up to 2 Peter chapter 3. And while you're doing that, let's just go before the Lord and release faith this morning to hear exactly what he wants us to hear. Amen. Father, we thank you for your word. Your word is life. Your word is truth, Father. It is sustaining power. It is healing to us. It is peace to us. It is joy to us. Father, I thank you so much for your word. Your word is life. It is foundational. It's everything that we need. And as we speak this morning, Holy Spirit, we ask you, we recognize you, we acknowledge you today. You've been sent specifically to help us, to teach us, to quicken us, to strengthen us. So we look to you for that exactly today, that you would give us ears to hear, hearts to receive, Father, from your word. Father, I thank you that I would speak accurately, precisely what you want today as I yield myself to you. I thank you for revelation knowledge, for impartations of truth, Father, for confirming your word this morning. And may you be glorified in all that is said and done in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord is good, right? So 2 Peter chapter 3, And we're going to just, I was in preparing for this, and then obviously having our candlelighting service on Wednesday, our Christmas Eve service, I knew this was the Sunday before Christmas. So I wanted the Lord just put something on my heart. It's going to be found, our text is 2 Peter chapter 3, primarily verse 14 and 15, but I do want to spend time, I want to read the whole chapter of 2 Peter 3, right? Does anybody have anything to do that's more important than this? All right, so faith comes by what? Hearing. Not just hearing somebody talk about their stories and opinions, but hearing the Word of God, the anointed words of Christ. So as we read that this morning, expect your faith to grow, because that's what His Word says, right? And now you may not feel like anything's happening. It may not seem like anything's happening, but by faith, a lot is happening. You're being quickened. You're being strengthened. There's healing flowing in your body, and you're receiving revelation knowledge. So we're going to read this morning, and I want to talk about preparing for the Lord's return. Preparing for the Lord's return. And, we are in the Christmas season, and I'm so thankful for what this time does represent. And I'm so thankful for Jesus. I'm so thankful for the gift that came into this world, born into sin, sinless because of the virgin birth, and lived and paid. He was the only one that can do this for mankind, to purchase our salvation again, to satisfy the judgment, and then give us our justification. Amen. Glory to God. You know, God is sovereign, and there was a judgment on sin that had to be paid. It wasn't something, how many understand that sin cannot be swept under the rug? It can't be swept under the rug. How many know that you can't do enough good things to take care of your sin issue? Do you understand that? Which is why Jesus had to come and die. Because judgment had to be served. Judgment had to be served. And it wasn't until the actual crucifixion that Jesus experienced spiritual death. Up to that point, he didn't have, he would be like we are, like a Christian, living his life just like we are. Think about this for a minute. He would be a Christian just like us, living his life, being moved by the unction of God, by the Holy Spirit, anointed with power to do the things that he told us to do. It wasn't until he went to the cross that he was spiritually separated. I don't think we really understand that, because picture yourself now being in Christ and then all of a sudden being separated from him. What would your life feel like? What would it be like? It would be hell. It'd be devastating. Jesus experienced that, but not until he went to the cross. And the minute he went to the cross and gave up the ghost, he became sin. He became the judgment, the payment, so that you and I today can have spiritual life, can have fellowship with the Father, can be guaranteed that when we leave this planet and we open our eyes again, we are in the presence of God. There was no way around that. That judgment had to be passed. And it was destined to fall on each and every one of us. It was. And we had to pay the penalty of sin, and that penalty would have been eternity in hell. Torment, destruction, death forever. So my goodness, when you begin to think, have we been given a gift that's greater than any other gift ever? Can you ever put a price tag on salvation? It's impossible. It's impossible, friends. It's impossible. Jesus came and became the judgment for our justification. And now, because he did, Jesus, God looked down and saw us on that cross. That's why we were crucified with Christ. And now we've been justified with him, and we've been made to sit at the right hand of the Father. Glory to God. That's why when he looks at us, he expects us to rule and reign as kings and priests and kings on this earth. and do the works that Jesus did. So 2 Peter chapter 3, I want to read this to us this morning. And we're really talking about preparing our lives for the Lord's return. Are we prepared for God to come back? If God was to sound that trumpet and Jesus came back within the next 5 minutes, which is very, very realistic, are we prepared? Are our lives prepared? Are our hearts in the condition that we would want them to be to stand before Jesus? And if the answer to that question is, I could probably do better, then guess what? It's time to do better, right? And we all can do better, right? Every one of us. But, you know, this time of year is when many people decorate their houses. They dress things up for the Christmas season, right? People elaborately decorate the interior of their homes. Sometimes they even have multiple Christmas trees for different rooms. I do. My kids all have one in their room. They like to decorate their tree. I have another little pencil one that goes up the steps. And then I have our big one in the... So we love trees. It looks festive and it just brings you into the Christmas spirit. But for a believer, it's more than just being in the Christmas spirit. I look at these things, I'm not like thrilled that I have to put up 8 trees in the house, but hey, for the sake of the family, we do these things, you know? And for the sake of peace at Christmas, we'll put up as many trees as we need to, and we'll decorate the outside to the best that we can, because they're all into that until it comes time to, oh, Dad, we'll do it with you. And then I'm out there, you know, alone, cold, by myself. But anyway, they line the exterior of their homes with trees and shrubs, colorful lights, all these things. People are so committed, and it's good. I'm glad they are. People are so committed to this tradition. In fact, they begin decorating a few days before Thanksgiving. We did this year. And then keep them decorations up until after the new year. It's so much work, I'm keeping mine up till March. Okay? Because it's way too much work for that short amount of time. I may even leave them up. Why not? Start a new trend. Today, people are more elaborate than ever before in the way they decorate their homes. And why am I saying this to you? Because I'm trying to draw a parallel here to how we decorate the outside. How is our heart decorated? Are we prepared? Is our heart just as decorated? It could take many hours and a lot of manpower and large amounts of money for people to adorn their homes the way they do today. It's expensive. In fact, they wanted me to do every little linear. I probably have 7,000 linear feet that they wanted lights on this year, and I just didn't do it. I put 2 nice big red spotlights, and it looks nice now. That's what everyone tells me anyway. They're not as happy with it, but next year, I promise them that I got to buy, and for me to do the kind of lights that I want them to be the big bulbs. They got to be super bright LED, and they got to be tight as can be, where every light is facing in the right direction, like a runway, if you will. So, but that costs a lot of money, you know that, and I didn't do it this year, obviously. But next year, I'm preparing for that. I'm preparing for that, and so it could cost a lot of money, a lot of man hours. The effect is beautiful, right? The effect of that is beautiful and changes a neighborhood, doesn't it? I mean, we ride up our street, and you know, you look at all the decorations, and everybody's houses look so nice, and it changes the neighborhood into a spectacular sight to see. You know, I'm not a big fan of the blow-up things. It's just personal. Just personal. And the reason why I'm not, and I'll tell you, is because when they're not inflated, it looks like people have garbage bags all over their front lawn. So I just don't like that look. So we don't do inflatables. It's our little inside joke, but anyway. So we usually don't do those. But however, regardless of how beautiful and ornate Christmas decorations are, and they are so beautiful, they are all seasonal and very temporary. Right? They're temporary. They go up and then they're taken away, taken down, put in boxes and stored until the next Christmas season rolls around. So the parallel that I'm wanting us to look at this morning is, are we prepared? I wonder while people put so much manpower, time, and money into decorating their houses and their trees to celebrate Christ's first coming, right? What kind of effort are we putting forth to prepare for his next coming? Think about that. Are we putting effort? Because the Lord is coming back. Church, he's coming back, and he's coming back sooner than people think. And how do we know this? Because the signs of the time dictate that and shows us. If you read scripture, if you read through the gospels in Matthew chapter 24, it clearly tells us. Revelation tells us. 2 Timothy tells us. What we're going to read right now in 2 Peter shows us these things. So let's with that in mind, let's read through this chapter. And then I want us a couple of points that I want to bring out for us to look at that is going to help us. So 2 Peter chapter 2, chapter 3 rather, chapter 3. And in fact, I want to read it from a different translation. I should have had this open already, but 2 Peter chapter 3. And again, our main text is going to be verses 14 and 15, but I just think it's going to do good for us to read this entire chapter because it's God's word. Amen. 2 Peter, let me get there, 3. Now, I'm reading, you probably know, nobody has this. I don't know if we do have it, but it's the ERV, which is the easy-to-read version because I like the way it says it, and it's easy to read. So follow along if you don't have that, or I don't know if we do, no big deal. Okay, that's fine. So just listen. It says, my friends, this is the second letter I have written to you. I wrote both letters to you to help your honest minds remember something. I want you to remember the words that the holy prophets spoke in the past. And remember the command that our Lord and Savior gave us. He gave us that command through the apostles. It is important for you to understand what will happen in the last days. Is everybody listening? This is important. We're tuned in, right? People will laugh at you. They will live following the evil they want to do. They will say, Jesus promised to come again. Where is he? Our fathers have died, but the world continues the way it has been since it was made. Verse 5, but these people don't want to remember what happened long ago. The skies were there, and God made the earth from water and with water. All this happened by God's word. Then the world was flooded and destroyed with water. And that same word of God is keeping the skies and the earth that we have now. Do you understand that? God's word keeps things in order in this universe. They are being kept to be destroyed by fire. They are kept for the day of judgment and the destruction of all people who are against God. All people. But don't forget this one thing, dear friends. To the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is just like a day. Trust me, the Lord is not being slow in doing what he promised, the way some people understand slowness. But God is being patient with you. He doesn't want anyone to be lost. He wants everyone to change their ways and stop sinning. This is why he has not come back yet. But the day when the Lord comes again will surprise everyone like the coming of a thief. The sky will disappear with a loud noise. Everything in the sky will be destroyed with fire, and the earth and everything in it will be burned up. One, just like that. Everything will be destroyed in this way. So what kind of people should we be? Our lives should be holy and devoted to God. We should be looking forward to the day of God, wanting more than anything else for it to come soon. When it comes, the sky will be destroyed with fire and everything in the sky will melt with heat. But God made a promise to us and we are waiting for what he promised. A new sky and a new earth that will be the place where goodness lives. Goodness lives. Verse 14. Dear friends, we are waiting for this to happen. So try as hard as you can to be found without sin and without fault. Try to be at peace with God. Remember that we are saved because our Lord is patient. Our dear brother Paul told you that same thing when he wrote to you with the wisdom that God gave him. That's what he says in all his letters when he writes about these things. These are parts of his letters that are hard to understand, and some people give a wrong meaning to them. These people are ignorant and weak in faith. They also give wrong meanings to the other scriptures, but they are destroying themselves by doing that. Dear friends, you already know about this, so be careful. Don't let evil people lead you away by the wrong they do. Be careful that you do not fall from your strong faith, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Glory be to him now and forever. Amen. So verse 14 in the Amplified says it like this. So beloved, since you are expecting these things, be eager to be found by him at his coming without spot or blemish. Without spot or blemish. Jesus was without spot or blemish, which is why he was able to be the propitiation, the sacrifice for mankind. He paid the judgment that was against us. We all had a judgment against us, a legal judgment because of sin. Legally, the enemy had every right. Every right. When Adam turned over his authority that God gave him and yielded to sin, by legal right, the enemy had power of attorney. He had a judgment that hung over our heads. And he had every right to do anything he wanted to mankind because we yielded to his lies and deceptions. Now, could we be mad at him for deceiving us? Yes. But who's at fault? We are. We are. So because of that, Jesus, God immediately came up with a plan, and it's called redemption. He abided by the legality of this whole compromise and fulfilled the judgment. He realized he couldn't have said, oh, well, look, I'm God, too bad. I'm sorry that you did that, but too bad. They're back to, no, he's honorable. Aren't you glad he is? Aren't you glad that he didn't take some shortcut? Because if he took a shortcut, that means he could take a shortcut now. But the Bible says that he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Unchanging. Abides by his own rule. Thank God he does. Because that means once you're saved and you've received the gift of repentance, that's not going to change. He honors that. But he wants us, when he returns, to be found spotless, wrinkle-free, without blemish, without being dominated by sin in this world, which we are infiltrated constantly by. Through every media outlet, every social thing that you can think of, it's in you, it's around you, which means that's why we need to spend time in the Word of God. Constantly, constantly. If you don't, strife will creep into your household. You'll be yielding to strife and you'll have nothing but confusion and evil operating in your home. The enemy wants to destroy families. You understand that? If he can destroy a family, if he can destroy a husband and a wife, then their kids, he can destroy the kids. And if the kids are destroyed, that unit becomes obsolete. And how does he do it? Through strife. Through strife is the number one way. He comes in through strife. He comes in through feelings of resentment. He comes in through feelings of insecurity. He comes in through feelings of jealousy. All these kind of things come in. And if we don't take them captive, recognize where they're from, then they're going to begin to have a stronghold in your house. It'll have a stronghold in you, which is going to control how you conduct yourself in your house. And if we allow that to happen and we're not in the Word, the only way around that, church, is being in the Word constantly. Because These thoughts are real. They're going to come to you. I'm not preaching up here saying that if you spend time in the Word, you'll never have to deal with these kind of feelings. On the contrary, you will deal with these feelings. They're going to come. Thoughts of insecurity, thoughts of jealousy, thoughts of all this kind of stuff are going to come. They're real. But if you're not, the way you deal with them is through the Word. If you're not in the Word, you are going to yield to the feelings. And you're going to have destruction in your house. And if it starts in your house, it's going to carry on into everything else. It'll carry on into your jobs. It'll carry on into your other relationships. And this is how the enemy destroys the church. You know, and that's why I say it all the time. As pastor here, we will not tolerate, and I won't make any room for strife in the church. And the minute we see it in any way, shape, or form, we're going to deal with it immediately. Immediately, because it's a detriment to the body. It is. Because when you yield to those things, what else follows strife? Think about this for a minute. Sickness follows strife. You can get so overwhelmed, so angry, so bitter, so full of fear, so full of jealousy that your physical health starts to fail. And then what happens when your health fails? We check out of here. This is the enemy's plan. This is the enemy's plan. So again, are we prepared for the Lord's return? When I stand up here and speak about spending time meditating on the Word day and night, it's for this purpose. It's for this purpose so that it's not a matter of if. There is no if. It's when it happens. Because the devil is the god of this world, and he's going to challenge believers on what they believe. And if we don't know what we believe, and we don't know how to combat him through the Word, then he's going to have the upper hand every time. Does everybody understand that? God wants his church prepared. Just like we decorate our houses, are we decorating our heart? Are we adorning our hearts with his Word? So finishing this verse, since you're expecting these things, be eager to be found by him at his coming, without spot or blemish, and at peace, in serene confidence, free from fears and agitating passions and moral conflicts. Moral conflicts. How do you do away with moral conflicts? It's pretty simple. It's pretty simple. If you're having a moral conflict, if it goes against the Word, stop doing it. Conflict over. Just like that. See how quick that happens? But again, can we do that if we're not in the Word? What did we say last Sunday? What were two things that I said? Come on now. All right, I guess you guys all got that. I don't know. God is never wrong, and his Word never fails. So if you're in moral conflict, stay on God's side, because he's never wrong. And when in doubt, trust God. Believe him. Do without. Does that mean you'll have to sacrifice and your flesh is not going to like it? That's exactly what it means. That's exactly what it means. It means your flesh is going to be, and it's going to whine and cry like a little baby. But that's what it is, a little baby. And the little babies don't run the show, right? We're led by the, or they shouldn't run the show. We're led by the Spirit, amen? Led by the Spirit. Verse 15 says this, and consider that the long-suffering of our Lord, his slowness in avenging wrongs and judgment and judging the world, I love the way this says this in the Amplified. Consider that the long-suffering of our Lord, his slowness in avenging wrongs and judgment and judging the world is salvation. That's what salvation is. Long-suffering of our Lord, this says, is salvation. That which is conducive to the soul's safety. To the soul's safety. Even as our beloved brother Paul also wrote to you, according to the spiritual insight given him. So two things I want us to look at today. Be prepared. Paul wrote this whole section. I mean, Peter wrote this entire section about how to be prepared for Jesus' return. And it's a task that requires entirely different level of dedication than it takes to put up Christmas decorations. Although you have to be dedicated to do that because, you know, if you wait to feel like doing it, you just won't do it, right? If we wait to feel like doing anything, there's a good chance we won't do it, right? So that takes dedication. But this level of being prepared takes a whole different level of dedication. Preparing for Christ's return requires a lifelong commitment. Say that, lifelong commitment. The C word. Does everybody like commitment? You should. We should. We should be committed. Now, if you're committed to the wrong thing, well, then that's your fault. But so before you commit yourself to something, the scripture talks about that too. Consider wisely what you're doing. But commitment, this is a lifelong commitment. Lifelong. Lifelong. So the first thing Peter pled with us to do, and I'll read it from the New King James in verse 14. Therefore, beloved, looking forward to these things. We need to look. We need to be looking forward for the next coming of the Lord. Now, I said it, no man knows the day or the hour, not even the angels, not Jesus himself knows the day or the hour that he's going to return. But one fine day, very soon, the Father's going to look over at the Son and say, get the trumpet out, because we're wrapping it up today. Isn't that going to be marvelous? I'd be happy if it happened right now. I'd be happy. Glory to God. So we need to be looking for the next coming of the Lord. And we know it's close. The word look is from a Greek word that means to earnestly wait for with sincere and unrelenting conviction. Did you hear that? To look means to wait for with sincere, honest, and unrelenting. In other words, something that will not quit, conviction. Do we have convictions in here? Is anybody convicted of things in this room, especially as a believer? Do we have a conviction of sin? Do we realize that morally and spiritually it's wrong to be a Christian and live the way the world does? Are we convicted of that? Yes. So that's a conviction. We need to live with the same unrelenting conviction looking forward to Christ's return. And friends, I have to tell you this. If we live our life that way, it'll make you live differently. If you're expecting him to come back in 10 minutes, there's going to be some things that you won't do. Did you hear me? If you think he's going to come back in 5 minutes, you may hold off on getting mad about something. Because when he comes, you don't want him to catch you mad. Because who knows what he's going to say? We want to be spotless. So do you see how it'll cause you to live differently? Totally different. If we're living our life fully expecting him to come within the next day or the next 5 minutes, it's going to affect decisions that we make. It's going to affect places that we go. Isn't it? It's going to prepare us for his return. There's going to be things that we may have thought about doing that we say, no, I don't want to do that because that's not a place I'd like to be when the Lord comes back. That's not something that I'd like to be doing when he comes, right? The scriptures tell us that he's going to come like a thief in the night. If the owner of a house knew at what time the thief was going to break in, he'd have been prepared for him, right? And he wouldn't have suffered his house to be torn apart. But of course, they're robbed and stolen from because they weren't prepared for it. Jesus is coming back the same way. So we can live a prepared life. But friends, let's not have this mindset that, oh man, if I got to live prepared, that means I can't do anything I enjoy. That's a lie. That's the biggest lie. That's the lie that the enemy wants the world to believe, which is why they don't receive Christ. I know from past experience, living the way I thought was great wasn't so great. Left a lot of heartache, left a lot of trouble, a lot of wreckage, a lot of problems.
since I've lived the way Christ wants me to live, and by his grace he helps me to do it every day, it is nothing but joy. Doesn't mean I don't have trials. Doesn't mean I don't have afflictions and attacks. But I have a supernatural peace that surpasses all understanding that enables me to go through them without being disrupted. And I always come out better than when I went into it. By faith, I declare that. So living prepared for Christ's return shouldn't be a negative thing. We shouldn't think of it as, oh man, well, there goes all the fun. That's what people think. You know? Is being broke and full of debt fun? You know, that happens by engaging in fun activity. A lot of times the result is broke, or you don't even know where your money is. You don't know where your car is. Think about what I'm saying for a minute. That's not fun. That's a lie. That's what the enemy wants us to think because he wants to destroy us. So let's not have this mindset, okay, well, now I got to live this prepared life because the Lord could come back any minute. So that means I just better join a monastery and put on a robe and just pray all day. That's not what it's saying. It's a heart condition. Do you understand? God wants you to enjoy everything on this earth that he made for us. And to the fullest, he told us that he's the good shepherd. We shall not want. He causes our cup to overflow. So it isn't a matter of sucking all the fun out of you. And now you're just this miserable monk that can't do a thing. And we just got to wait until he comes. It's not what it is. That's what the world thinks, because that's the picture the enemy creates. But we're not miserable monks. Not that monks are miserable, I'm just saying. They're dedicated. They're committed. Maybe we should be a little more like that. But anyway, but it's a matter of living the good life, the God life. The God life, having your, let me ask you this, being led by the Spirit, is that a bad thing? That's a great thing. Is avoiding every trouble and obstacle in your life a good thing or a bad thing? That's a good thing. So as you're led by the Spirit, you're going to be prompted to maybe not go to some places, and your flesh is going to go, but we want to go, but everybody's doing that. And the Holy Spirit on the inside of you is saying, don't do that. Don't do that. You'll be happy that you didn't. And the flesh is screaming, but look how much fun. Look at what all this kind of stuff. And this is the fight of faith. And the Holy Ghost on the inside is saying, you shouldn't do that. And he's not screaming, very subtle, very quiet, like a gentleman. You shouldn't do that. Now, if we'll trust him instead of our whining baby flesh that's screaming, that forgets how miserable things are, right? You know, no, man, you know, in the past when maybe you've indulged in too much alcohol, right? And you've woke up feeling like you just got hit by a bus the next day. How many have said, I'll never do that again? If I can lay on the floor and put my legs up, I'd say, I'll never do that again until you start to feel good again and you forget all about that. You know, there's a proverb that talks about that. It's called foolishness. Just like a dog returns to its vomit, so does a fool repeat the same foolish stuff. The flesh so quickly forgets that it wasn't as great as it seemed to be. Meanwhile, the Holy Ghost is trying to lead you down a path that gets brighter and brighter and brighter. So prepare, living a prepared life for his return, I'm trying to show you, is not a bad thing. It's going to avoid the problems. It's going to avoid the pitfalls. The Holy Ghost will show us if we'll listen to him. But we're going to have the flesh to contend with. We're going to have our minds to contend with. That's going to come, false reasoning that's going to come. And we're going to try to think, and we're going to try to reason, and we're going to try to justify. And that's all the flesh, and that's the enemy. We have to be so resolute that, no, I'm not even going to entertain that. I'm being led by the Spirit. And then open your Bible and start reading it. Because you can't just try to get it out of, I'm just not going to think about it. I'm just going to try to block it out. You cannot just try to block it out. You need to replace it with the Word, with the word. If you find yourself struggling with a moral conviction or a conflict, get out the scripture. And I'm telling you, it won't be long, maybe 5 minutes, and you'll be over that conflict because you're going to see what the word says. And when the entrance of his word gives us light. But if we don't do that, then we're going to sit here and try to fight a spiritual battle in the flesh. And we'll lose that fight every time. But if we'll prepare our hearts and expect the Lord to return, because he is, it's going to cause us to live differently. It's going to cause us to live a fulfilled, prosperous, healthy, happy life. How many want nothing more than peace and love and joy and harmony in your household? I'll tell you what, you couldn't put, it's worth more than millions of dollars. I'm really serious. I am so serious. You can have all the money in the world and then walk into your house and have nothing but turmoil. That money cannot help you. Can we have peace? Can we have that in our households? We absolutely can if we will all yield to the Spirit of God. If we'll give his word first place in our lives. We'll be full of peace. We'll be full of life. We'll be full of health. We'll be well supplied. We'll have every need met according to his riches and glory. And the devil will have no place. You give him no room. He can't get in. You seal. I taught a message here about sealing up the cracks. You know, how the enemy slips in and gains a foothold in our lives. Talking about looking, earnestly waiting with sincere and unrelenting conviction. Unrelenting conviction. That means conviction that will not quit. Have you ever used that term before? Man, this is like unrelenting. When you were using that, you were probably disgusted at somebody or something. Right? You're like, this is unrelenting. I mean, what? When? It's constant. Yes. You understand. That's how we are to live. Our conviction needs to be that way. That means things are going to come against our convictions. And as you get disgusted at unrelenting things in your life, that's how you need to be when it comes to your convictions. I refuse to budge off my conviction. I don't care. I don't care if the rest of the world is doing it. If it goes against my moral conviction, I am unrelenting in my stance. I will not move. I will not move. Now, that takes, I know we're talking about, but that takes a great amount of effort and time in God's word to not be moved off your conviction. Do not be deceived. Do not think that if you don't, you only read your Bible when we open it on Sunday mornings, that you're going to be a person that can stand unrelenting in their conviction. Please, friends, I'll tell you right now, not even close. Not even close. In fact, every day in the Word, day and night, it's difficult. But it's doable. But it's doable, right? We're soldiers. So can soldiers deal with difficult things? Yes, they train for that. They train for that. We're not weekend warriors. We're fully enlisted, hardcore, elite soldiers. So, yes, we can deal with that. We can deal with that. So we need to be looking. We need to be prepared. Unrelenting conviction. Christ coming for the church should be such a reality in our hearts that we constantly wait for it with a conviction that consumes us and keeps us on our toes. You hear that? I'm going to say it again. Christ coming for the church should be such a reality to us in our hearts that we constantly wait for it, constantly wait for it, with a conviction that consumes us and keeps us on our toes. That goes exactly what I was talking about. When we live this way, you're gonna take a second thought about going and doing certain things. It keeps you on your toes. It's called being vigilant. It's called being steadfast. It's called being sober-minded. That's what it's called. You know, I thought about this morning, having a extensive background in the fire service. We don't necessarily use these 10 codes anymore, but this came right up to me when I was thinking about this. Always being alert, always being ready. Always being ready. Preparedness is being ready because our lives in the fire service and here depend on it. We cannot be negligent and slack, but we always used to, if we would respond to a fire call, you know, when I was chief or even when I was a captain, we would get in the apparatus and we would say, District 1, we're 2631, we're 10-8, which means we are en route and in service, ready to go and responding to the call. And then when we got on location, we'd say we're 10-9, we're on location. 10-7 was always, we're out of service. You know, 10-7 meant out of service. And so when I was reading this morning, we should never be 10-7. Never. Now, 10-7, we would take ourselves out of service because if the pump broke on the engine or we had to replace hose, whatever it was, well, we were unavailable to respond to an emergency at that moment. So we would tell the dispatcher, listen, engine 31 is 10-7. As believers, there are too many that are 10-7. Sitting in churches, 10-7. 10-7. Meaning, I'm here, but I'm out of service. I'm out of service. In other words, God, you can't count on me for anything. Think about that for a second. Let me say that again. God, I'm 10-7. Help me all you can, but don't count on me for one thing. Now, I know that's hard, but that's truth. And the Bible says that you'll know the truth and it'll make you free. We are preparing for Christ's return. This is a real event, church, that is happening. That is happening. The world may tell you you're nuts. You've been saying this for thousands of years. The only reason it hasn't happened is because God cares about the lost. That's why it hasn't happened already. And there's people who need to hear the truth. So as believers, can we afford to sit here 10-7 out of service? Saying, God, I love you so much. Continue to help me and my family. But please don't count on me for anything. Because that's what we're saying most of the time. In fact, most of the church is saying that. Help me, Lord, but don't count on me. No, we need to say, God, thank you for everything you've done. I am fully in service. I am relentless in my conviction. I am 10-8. I am, you tap me, I'll go and do and respond to any assignment. Any emergency, God, I'm your person. I'm in service. Guys, do you hear that? That is important. Being prepared for his return. We need to be looking. Secondly, verse 14 says, beloved, since you are expecting, be eager. Where am I at?
I got it. I was reading from the Amplified. So look forward to these things first. Then it says to be diligent. Be diligent to be found by him in peace, without spot and blameless. In peace. Diligent in waiting for the Lord to come. The word diligent is the Greek word spadazo. Now, I know you wanted to know that, so I figured I'd tell you so you can practice your Greek, you know, at dinner today. But which gives the sense. Diligent gives the sense of constant readiness and diligence. A constant readiness. High alert. High alert. Are we on high alert? High alert means we are very well conscious and aware of the time that we're living in and that Jesus could come back within the next 30 seconds. That's on high alert. Do we know people who don't know the Lord right now? Yes. Do we? Yes. Then we should be on high alert rescuing them because they're about to go to the pit of hell. Think about this for a minute. I mean, we're not. We aren't, thank God. But we all know friends. So many that in the next 30 seconds, if God was to come back for the church, they would go to hell while we sit around 10-7 when we need to be 10-8 in service. If you know people that don't know the Lord, what are we doing about it? What are we doing about it? This isn't condemning. This is convicting us. It convicts me. Because I know a lot of people who don't know the Lord. Am I doing all that I possibly can to see to it that they hear the message of hope? Am I? I have to ask myself that. And if I'm convicted that I'm not, then I better get up off my butt and do something. That's what it comes down to. God is not interested in playing church sanctuary and let's play house. He's not into that. He's into the world who he loves so much and who gave his son for that they can hear the truth. How are they going to hear it? They're going to hear it from us, believers who are looking diligently and prepared for his return. It means to work hard, diligent. It means to work hard, to give it your best shot, to give it effort, or to commit yourself to it entirely and constantly at all costs. At all costs. Now, only we can answer that question, whether we're doing that or not. And it doesn't take long to answer. We know in our hearts already. And I believe that the Spirit of God is trying to prompt us and quicken us to come up in our service. He's wanting us to do a better job. He wants us to do a better job. And we should be willing to do that. After all, by his grace, we've already found light and truth. And it's only by his grace and his mercy. We're not better than any other person that's without Christ. We're not. We're not better than any of them. We have only been redeemed because we accepted the gift. And thank God for the person who told you about it. What if they decided to be 10-7 and out of service? God, don't count on me for doing anything. What if they were? Think about that for a minute. There's thousands of people that have heard the message coming from this church because somebody stood up and accepted that. And somebody shared that with the somebody from here who stood up. Had that other person not been obedient, how many thousands of people may not have heard the message? We have no idea the impact in our obedience makes. And being committed and being diligent and living by our convictions. This is a sobering message. And you know, maybe you came here wanting to hear some happy Christmas message. Well, this is a happy Christmas message. This is. The flesh might not think so, but who cares? We don't walk according to the flesh. We walk according to the Spirit. Your spirit right now is rejoicing. So tell your flesh to get in on it. Put a smile on your face and say, I am so happy for this beautiful Christmas message. Because it's the Spirit of God. We yield to him. We're saying exactly what he wants said, not what I came up with. This is not my opinion. It's not my philosophy. It's the Word of God we're talking about. We're talking about souls. The most precious thing to God the Father is people, humanity. Humanity. Diligent. Work hard. Give it your best shot. Give it effort. Commit yourself to it entirely and constantly. In other words, this kind of preparation is not seasonal or on and off, according to the whims of our emotions. All right? Did you hear that? So what do I mean by that? I've already touched on this a little bit, but it's worth touching again. It's not seasonal. It's not on and off according to the whims of our emotions. You know how many people are led according to their emotions? Some people aren't here this morning because their emotions got the best of them. I don't know who they are, so I'm not talking about anybody in particular, but I can venture to say that people got up this morning and it was rainy, snow. Maybe we'll just watch it online. Do you hear what I'm saying? And that's not judging, because we can all fall prey to that quick if we're not in the Word. But thank God you guys are here. You made the best choice. Glory to God. And I know that, and that's not condemning, I know that there's people who couldn't be here, and so we're thankful that you're faithful tuning in the way you are now. But if the shoe fits, just slip it on nicely and make some preparation. That's all. No one needs to know. Okay? This kind of preparation is not a seasonal thing, and not why I'm saying seasonal, because it's the holiday season. It's not on and off, and it's not according to our emotions. because sometimes your emotions is sky high. You're like, man, I could decorate the world today. And then sometimes you don't want to get out of the bed. So if you're led by your feelings, what kind of a person are you going to be? A roller coaster, a yo-yo, up and down, up and down. And if we're only waiting for the good feeling to get anything done, there's a good chance you're not going to get mostly anything done. Nobody feels like going to work, right? You don't wake up and go, man, this is the best day to work. Just look at this gorgeous day. I cannot wait to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning to drive to the city. No, you don't do it that way. It's not based on how you feel. You do it because it's a commitment. You have to. You have to. So this kind of preparation that we're talking about isn't a seasonal and emotional thing. And yeah, you know what? Today's good. And maybe I'll share Jesus with somebody today because I just feel happy. But tomorrow you wake up, you feel like the Grinch, and you're like, I'm not telling anyone about this Jesus. Think about what I'm saying. It is a firm commitment to constantly be ready for the coming of Christ. Do we have that convenience of feeling like the Grinch if the God is coming back in 3 minutes? No, we can't. And we don't know if he is or not. So guess what? Grinch gone. No Grinches. No Grinches. Happy, jolly Saint Nick, okay, is who we need to be. Christians, Christ-like, prepared. Is your heart prepared? Grinchy, he's my friend. That's the funniest part of, that's the newest Grinch, right? I don't know if you, whatever, I'm not going to sit here and tell the story, but whatever, watch it, it's funny, but there's that one part, the guy goes, oh, Grinchy, he's my friend, he's my good friend. Anyway, we laugh all the time, so, but check it out, it's good. So, when I say diligent, I'm talking about a perpetual attitude that is conscientious and persistent. Conscientious and persistent, and that never lets go, constantly preparing for Christ's return for his saints. That's the kind. It's a conviction that you never stop being ready, and you're prepared for that grand moment. Grand moment. Living. Have you ever noticed that there were times in your life that you would have thought, you know what? You feel like you have this sense in you that spiritually you're doing good. You've been spending time in the Word, and you there was no condemnation. You felt pure and you felt right good with God, right? There's times we've all felt like that, right? Because we were doing what we were supposed to, and you may have even said, man, the Lord came back right now. This would be great. I know he'd be happy with me. I'd be happy with him, and everything would be good. That is the kind of living that I'm talking about. And that is not based on a feeling. That is based on a choice that we make. Either we're going to yield to the Spirit or we're going to yield to the flesh. And if we yield to the flesh, we're going to be looking at the things of the flesh. We're going to be looking out here instead of looking in here and in His Word. But if we're led by the Spirit, we will be prepared for that grand moment. It is decorating one's life with godly traits every day of the year. Just like we decorate our houses. And, you know, you may not do it all in one day, but every day you're adding something. You're doing this, you're doing this. You're buying new ornaments, you're buying this, you're doing all that kind of stuff. Being diligent and prepared is decorating your life with godly traits every day of the year. Every day of the year. If Christmas time reminds us of anything, it should be that since he has come once, he will come again. He did come once. And you know what we need to remind ourselves of? When he came, he already was before he came. Yes. Like the first time he showed up on the scene wasn't as a little infant. He was the Word in the beginning. In the beginning. And he laid that aside. He laid that royalty aside and humbled himself and came here in the form of a servant to be the judgment payment for our sin. Thank God. Thank God that Jesus did that. Thank God that God loved us so much that he'd be willing to give up his son. I wouldn't be willing to give up my kids to save the world. I'm serious, and that's why I'm not God. God, I'm being honest. I mean it, and no one else in here can say you would do the same, because you wouldn't. So everybody be honest together, okay? It's fine. God knows who gets the grace, right? The humble, the honest, yes. So that's why we're not God, because I would have said, the heck with them. No, I'm just kidding. No, I'm not kidding, actually. So Christmas time reminds us that if he came once, he's coming again. He's coming again. Therefore, we must constantly be on guard and in a state of preparation. State of preparation. So that he will find us fully spiritually decorated upon his arrival. You hear that? Fully decorated upon his arrival. So I'm going to ask you today, in closing, I think in closing, I have 4 pages of closing notes, so that's all right. No, I'm only kidding. We're good. So I do want to ask you today, all of us, I'm speaking to myself, allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us right now. This is important. What are we doing? All of us. I'm an under-shepherd here. He's the shepherd. God has given me the humble and gracious responsibility to lead his flock, his sheep. And I take it serious. Very. What are we doing to make sure our spiritual life is fully decorated with life, with godliness, purity, and spiritual power when Christ comes? This is something that, you know, we need to leave here today and then go home and meditate on and maybe listen to it again and allow the Spirit of God to continue to talk to us. If he were to come today, would he find us adorned with these godly attributes or lacking them? I mean, maybe he hasn't come today because he knows we need to get some decorations put on. And he knows that there are certain amount of people who have not heard the truth yet. His mercy. Would he find us adorned with these godly attributes, or would we be lacking them? As you spend manpower, time, and money to decorate your physical house, it would be prudent for us to ask ourselves if Christ would find these other vital qualities in our life when he returns for his church. Are we putting as much into our heart and spiritual conditions as we are putting into our physical decorations? That's something for us to think about today. And I pray that through the Holy Spirit speaking and ministering to our hearts today, that we would rise to the occasion, that we would stir ourselves up, that we would become diligent and convicted and fully convinced and persuaded that Christ's return is soon and very soon. And in doing that, in being led by the Spirit, we'll live our very best that we can. And when the Lord comes back, we'll be prepared at any given moment. And because we're prepared, we're doing his work. We're doing his will. If we're prepared, that means we're sharing with the friends that we know who don't know Christ. We're sharing Christ with them if we're prepared. And the sooner the world hears it, the sooner he'll return. The sooner he'll return. So the best gift that you can receive for yourself and that you can give to somebody else is a gift of life. Eternal life. Eternal life. The gift of salvation. It's not of works. You can't earn it. You can't be good enough. You can't be holy enough. It's a gift. It's a grace. It's a mercy that is undeserved, but has been purchased and given to us, and we take it by faith. And so that's the gift that I want us to prepare our hearts for and to share this Christmas season. You know, I know that that times are a little different right now as far as being able to have the gatherings that we normally have. But I'm sure we're going to come across family members that may not know the truth. And I'm not telling you to take your Bible and shove the whole thing down their throat. Okay? Because that wouldn't be wisdom either. But I'm talking about, you know what leaves the most impact on their life? With that which you don't say. But what they see leaves a longer lasting impact than any word you can possibly say. So what do I mean? Live like Christ. Act like Christ. Prefer. Do unto others as you would want done unto you. You know, let love prevail. Those are the kind of attributes. When your family and friends see that, they'll notice something very different about you without you having to say, I'm a Christian and I belong to Abundant Grace Church. Read this. Because they're going to be like, dude, you're a weirdo. It's what we thought. You know, and we always knew it. And now it's true. Don't do that. Okay? Because we're not weird. We're real. We're real loving people who love a real God. And who's real to us. So share salvation with your lifestyle. How about that? Not in just your word, but in your lifestyle. Because if your lifestyle exemplifies Christ, that gets somebody's attention. Then when you speak, they're going to listen. Because everyone will tell you talk is cheap. Isn't it? We could teach a parrot to give a salvation message to some degree. But when it's experienced through your lifestyle, it leaves a lasting impact. Why don't we stand up on our feet? Praise God. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Let's just lift our hands towards heaven. Thank God for the for salvation, for Jesus. Thank him for the Holy Ghost. Thank him for this great and marvelous gift of salvation that he freely gave to us and that we just humble ourselves and receive by faith. We confess with our mouth. We believe in our heart that Jesus is the Son of God, that he was born of a virgin, came and lived his life as an example for us to follow, and then went to the cross and was spiritually separated from his Father, becoming the sin of the world, so that we can receive the gift of salvation. And Father, we're so thankful that you did that for us. And Father, you didn't do it just for us. You did it for mankind, for all who would hear and believe. And so we're so grateful, Father. I pray for the church here today, and for all of us, your children. You are the good shepherd. We are your sheep. Father, I pray that conviction would continue to speak to our hearts. Moral conviction, preparedness of heart as we hunger and thirst for righteousness, Father, as we live lives conducive, spotless, without blemish, ready for your return, Lord. I thank you that your blessing would flow on us, Father, would manifest in our lives, in our families, in our jobs, in all our relationships, Father, as we follow hard after you, especially during this Christmas season, Father. Show us, reveal to us, quicken to us opportunities that we have to share your love, your goodness, for it is the goodness of God that causes people to change their ways and repent. So, Father, we ask you to for our family members, Father, to grant them the gift of repentance. Yes. The gift of repentance. It's a gift. Yes. And may we be the bearer of that to help them. And I just want to give this invitation right now. Please do not leave church today without knowing for sure that you are born again and that Jesus is your Lord and your Savior. The best gift you'll ever receive in your life. It's the gift of eternal life as opposed to eternal death. Eternal death. It's dying and never being able to die. It's awful. It's torment. But there's eternal life. Full of joy, full of glory. Yes. If you're in this place today, I don't care if you've been coming here for 30 years. It makes no difference. And you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. There is no, today is the day of salvation. There is no better time than right now. But especially during this Christmas season, as we celebrate the birth as he came to earth of our Savior. If you don't know him, I want you to raise your hand because we want to pray with you this morning. I want you to know that you're born again. And those who are watching online, there is no distance in the Spirit. If this message spoke to your heart and you feel conviction in your own heart right now, then please respond. We have our associate pastor. We have our elders that are watching our feed right now. That we want to pray with you. We have material that we want to put in your hand. We want you to know that you're not alone in this new adventure. And if you want to receive Christ, please let us know. Type in the comment. There is no shame. The only shame would be rejecting Christ. That's a shame. That's a shame. We've all had to come to the place of humility and surrender in our lives and to receive Christ. So if you're in this room or you're watching us online, wherever you may be, please let us know if you're online. Comment. If you're in here, raise your hand. I want to see. I want to pray with you. I want to pray with you. Glory to God. Everybody in this room knows for certain that you're prepared for his return. And you're going to shore up some things even more. Right? Glory to God. And if you're watching online again, please comment. Let us know. We will pray with you. We want to put stuff in your hand. And you're not alone in this. We're here for you. So why don't we lift our hands towards heaven? Those at home, wherever you're at, lift your hands wherever you're at and thank God for this great salvation. Father, we thank you. Lift your voices. Thank him. I mean, we should be very vocal. If someone came in here and wrote you a check for $1 million, I guarantee you wouldn't be all religious. You'd be thanking them and yelling all over the place. God gave you much more than $1 million. Much more than $1 million can be gone. You can use it, but you can't waste eternal life. It's forever. So, Father, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Father, for the gift of salvation. The greatest gift. If I never received anything else, I'd be more than happy with my salvation. Knowing that I will be with you forever, Father, that there is no death. There is no sting in death. It's a transportation from here to heaven. Glory to God. And, Father, we're thankful that you made that possible. Because of your great love with which you loved us. Even while we were miserable people, you loved us. And you made a way for us to receive salvation and live with you forever, forever. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I could never, ever thank you enough. Never could I thank you enough. Thank you, Lord. May you be glorified. We thank you for your word today, Lord. We thank you that it is producing in the lives of everyone who heard it. It is incorruptible, and it always accomplishes what it's sent forth to do. Your word never, ever fails. Father, we honor it, we cherish it, and we thank you for your goodness, your protection, Father, during this holiday season, your Holy Spirit who leads us and guides us. Father, we thank you for long, healthy, satisfied lives full of wisdom. Thank you, Lord. To you be all the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you all. Remember, Wednesday, we have our candlelight service. Please be here. And that's at 7 o'clock. And we look forward to seeing you then. God bless you.